determined. I felt too that I accepted the illness straight away. My Loma and me are going to be lifelong buddies, so I have to get along with it. And I can't honestly remember ever asking, why me, or thinking, why did I get cancer? Why does anyone get cancer? I think it was important for me to move on from the diagnosis and to get straight into the treatment of the illness. And I suppose I felt if I was focusing on why me or poor me, it would stop me from giving all my energies to fighting the disease. Of course, it's not possible to be a positive 100% of the time, and that's fine too. I also felt hopeful that after my initial doubts that I would fight this disease and come out the other side, and thankfully I did. In terms of fun, well, my sense of humour helped a lot. There were days when if I didn't laugh, I would have cried, so I laughed a lot. But I think the single most important factor in my recovery was and continues to be my faith. I'm lucky that I have a strong faith because I couldn't deal with this illness without putting it into the context of faith. In July, when I was going through the harshest of my treatment, there were some days when I did feel very close to God and to Mary in particular. I suppose the fact that I first showed symptoms on the Feast of the Immaculate Conception, and then during the worst of my treatment, she seemed to reach out to me and gave me the strength I needed to get through some tough days. I was given another piece of scripture in a little frame by a friend of mine about 2 days after I was diagnosed with cancer. He brought it to me in hospital and it sat by my bed at home and each time I was admitted to hospital. The piece is from Corinthians and it says, "You can trust God not to let you be tried beyond your strength. And with any trial, he will give you a way out of it and the strength to bear it." I firmly believe that to be true. God will only ever send us what he knows we can handle. The trial that I was sent on, the journey I've been on over the past few years, has, if anything, made my faith stronger. I never felt angry with God. He sent me a trial he knew I could handle. But God had also given me, through my faith, the ability to hope for better days and to deal with the darkness. My faith is different now. It's deeper, perhaps, since my illness, and I'm working harder with my children on nurturing their faith and their beliefs. Thankfully, my transplant was a success, and on the 26th of September 2007, I was told I was in remission. Emotionally, I'm very different too. My attitudes to life and the world around me have changed. As the Americans say, I don't sweat the small stuff in life. I cherish each day and I look forward with hope to the days, weeks, months, and hopefully years ahead. There are a lot of simple things in life that I don't take for granted anymore. My children telling me they love me makes me stop in my tracks in a way that maybe I didn't stop before because I was rushing around doing something. Time is a precious commodity for me now, and I've learned to say no to a lot of things that I would have said yes to before. And I've become a little bit more selfish than I would have been with my time and my energy, but that's an okay kind of selfishness. My ambitions, my hopes in life have changed too. My hope now is to grow old with my husband and to be around for my children as they grow up. To see my little boy making his communion and confirmation and to be there for my daughter to help her with secondary school and all the challenges that comes with growing up. A longer term ambition is to be around for them as they start college or their first job and to see them walk down the aisle on their wedding days. It's thinking about all these things that gives me the determination and the cast iron will to fight. But it's also thinking about the possibility of not being around for these things that can sometimes bring me to tears. It's the little things too that I don't want to miss either, like being around to tell them to tidy their rooms and do their homework. I am definitely a stronger person than I was before my illness. Very little fazes me in life now, except maybe speaking at Novenas. I feel like I can take on the world and win, but for now I'm happy to be a wife, a mum, a sister, a daughter, a friend and a colleague. And I'm one of the lucky ones because I know that there are a lot of people who are just not able to return to the lives they had before a diagnosis of cancer. Since recovering from my transplant, I've been able to go back to most things I was doing. I'm back at work, I've rejoined the gym, I'm back able to swim 20 lengths, I can cycle too. I climbed Kilpatrick in July 2008 to mark the first anniversary of my transplant. It was something I'd never done before and I don't know if I'll ever do it again, it was so hard. It was hard to believe, standing at the top of it, that a year previously I had been in death's door in the hospital. I've also become a scout leader, and during the past few years I have done all manner of things like camping, hostelling, hiking, and staying in a haunted castle. I'm really lucky that I can do all this, although from time to time I do have some setbacks, some serious, some minor. I'm lucky that I'm on phase 1 of treatment and responding well. am very lucky to have my crown of health back. Well, maybe more of a tiara than a crown. Going through my illness and coming out the other side has made me realise that a diagnosis of cancer or a diagnosis with any serious illness is not hopeless. Yes, it is challenging, but never hopeless. And it's thanks to my faith that I was able to grasp this. I've been given this illness and it has made me become a better person and made me focus on the important things in life. I know that my time on earth is probably shorter than what it should be, and I have to make the most of what time I have. This illness has made me realise that life is full of hope. My life is full of hope and healing every day. I'm very lucky and very blessed that I've been given the chance to take stock of my life and to change my perspective and goals. And perhaps it's only when we are faced with death that we really understand the value of our life, the fragility of life, the challenge that has been set before us to live life to the best we can, to take time for the little things in life, for the small everyday joys that filter through even when everything else seems to be going wrong, to take time to tell the people around us that we love them, and not just to tell them, but to show them, really to celebrate the hope that every new day brings, and to celebrate the everyday, ordinary miracles that exist in all our lives, whether we realise it or not. I try to live each day like the ordinary miracle it is. I'm glad that I have a family to be part of that miracle, and I have faith to believe that life is a gift, wrapped up for me, and I hope to spend the next 40 years unwrapping it slowly and savouring it. And I want to finish by reading a couple of verses by Liam Lawton from his beautiful book, The Hope Prayer. It's called Prayer for Healing, and I offer it for all those who are sick, especially those included in the petitions tonight. A prayer for healing. Lord, illness has come to me when I least expect it, coming to me without an invitation, so swiftly that I've had no time to prepare. But you knew, Lord, and you know me well. You know my fears, how much I worry, so much anxiety, I do not need to tell. Help me to befriend this illness, my silent companion, this intrusion, this invasion of my serenity and soul. Heal the deep darkness that surrounds me. Heal the fears that confound me. Bring bright, beautiful moments of healing light through the closed shutters of my paralysis. Help these days to be not the end, but merely the beginning of transformation in my life. Hold me during the deepest moments of despair. Place words on my lips that become your prayer. Thank you for listening.